in the cold. Bring winter jasmine as its buds unfold. Bring the Christmas life into this house. Bring red and green and gold. Bring things that shine. Bring candlesticks and music, food and wine. Bring in your memories of Christmas past. Bring in your tears for all that you have lost. Bring in the shepherd boy, the ox and ass. Bring in the stillness of an icy night. Bring in the birth of hope and love and light. Bring the Christmas life into this house. Imagine striking a match that night in the cave. Use the cracks in the floor to feel the cold. Use crockery in order to feel the hunger and to feel the desert, but the desert is everywhere. Imagine striking a match in that midnight cave, the fire, the farm beasts in outline, the farm tools and stuff. And imagine, as you towel your face in the towel's folds, the bundled up infant and Mary and Joseph. Imagine the kings, the caravan's stilted procession as they make for the cave, or rather, three beams closing in and in on the star. The creaking of loads, the clink of a cowbell. But in the cerulean thickening over the infant, no bell and no echo of bell. He hasn't earned it yet. Imagine the Lord, for the first time from darkness and stranded immensely in distance, recognizing himself in the Son of Man, homeless, going out to himself in a homeless one.
Spotless glory, 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 spotless glory
before the winter morn, before the earliest cock crow, Jesus Christ was born. Born in a stable, cradled in a manger, in the world his hands had made, born a stranger. Priest and king lay fast asleep in Jerusalem. Young and old lay fast asleep in crowded Bethlehem. Saint and angel, ox and ass, kept a watch together before the Christmas daybreak in the winter weather. Jesus on his mother's breast in the stable cold, spotless Lamb of God was he, shepherd of the fold. Let us kneel with Mary maid, with Joseph bent and hoary, with saint and angel, ox and ass, to hail the King of Glory. so that is that. Now we must dismantle the tree, putting the decorations back in their cardboard boxes. Some have got broken, and carrying them up to the attic. The holly and the mistletoe must be taken down and burnt, and the children got ready for school. There are enough leftovers to do, warmed up, for the rest of the week. Not that we have much appetite, having drunk such a lot, stayed up so late, attempted quite unsuccessfully to love all our relations, and in general, grossly overestimated our powers. Once again, as in previous years, we have seen the actual vision and failed to do more than entertain it as an agreeable possibility. Once again, we have sent him away, begging, though, to remain his disobedient servant, the promising child who cannot keep his word for long. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And all went to be taxed, every one into his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee out of the city of Nazareth into Judea unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were, in that same country, shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. Ye shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. And it came to pass, as the angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said one to another, Let us go, even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which is come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us. And they came with haste, and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning the child. And all they that heard it wondered at those things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart.
Thank you.
three of us stood at the base of the streetlight, looking towards the tiny bungalow. Christmas lights draped the porch, and the tree in front of the window shimmered red and white and green through the glass. We stood frozen by the wind whipping the freshly fallen snow and with indecision. I don't know. We don't want to... My voice fell away. We don't want to what? Make them sad? Make them happy? Make them remember and long for what might have been? All of us stood thinking the same thoughts, pulled toward the little house, but caught in our own memories of the Christmas Eve before. Exactly 1 year ago, we'd also stood at the foot of this lamppost, and it had been snowing and cold, colder in fact, and we'd been four, like tonight, Felipe and Jack, myself and Bianca, Felipe's beloved little goat. That night, Felipe had said, "It's 10:30 and it's snowing, and look, she's shivering." "She trembles," said Jack. "Come on, Felipe, it's a goat thing. When she's not eating, she's trembling." "That's goatist," said Felipe. "I don't think I can accept that blatant prejudice, that clear goatism." A push, a snowbank, some rolling, some rubbing of faces in the freshly and still falling snow. And then stillness. The four of us, including Bianca, lay on the dry, white blanket and looked up into the Christmas Eve sky, stars shining with a more spectacular, more piercing brightness than usual. The Milky Way more pack-like, Orion a more brave, more daring sky hunter than even a week before. What is it, do you think, that makes a Christmas sky so magic? "Well, the goat, of course," from Felipe. "Stop it, I mean it." "So do I. The goatential for great happenings." I rubbed Bianca's muzzle. "She is special." "Of course she is," said Jack. "She's a bringer of joy," from Felipe, her besotted guardian. Felipe and Jack, best friends to each other and to me, had convinced me that our search for the meaning of Christmas would only be successful if we found a way to give maximum joy to the maximum number of inhabitants of our small village that Christmas Eve. And what that meant to Felipe was sharing the sweetness of Bianca and his love of singing. So we tied a red ribbon around Bianca's neck and coaxed her through the snow, door to door, and through the hallways of the tiny nursing home, singing and laughing with the old folks. And now, nearly at the end of the village, we were back in the snow again, lying on the lawn of a tiny bungalow. Sitting up, Felipe began in his most beautiful tenor, "O Holy Night," and the church bells began to ring 11. "We really should go." I was getting to my feet when a voice I didn't know said, "Please don't. Come in and sing for us. I can't tell you what it would mean." We all turned to the voice coming from the steps of the bungalow where a young man stood pulling a sweater close around him. "Oh, that was lovely. It's just what we need. But please come in and let us give you a drink. Hot chocolate, scotch, in exchange for a song. That's usually the deal, isn't it?" "Bianca too?" Felipe wouldn't stand for the exclusion of his pet. "Bianca, too," laughed the young man. "We won't be accused of goatism here." Smiles of recognition all around, and we trooped into the little house. The front of the house was one living space with a huge stove at its heart. And in front of the stove, an ancient armchair where a beautiful woman sat cuddling a child wrapped chin to toes in a soft, pale blanket. "This is Maddie," said our host, "and her mom, Allison, and I'm Paul. Maddie, look! Look at our visitors. What a treat! Singers and a lovely little kid!" Solemnly, the little girl sat up with a kind of care and precision I'd never seen in a child. "She's not a kid," said Maddie. "She's a goat." "Are goats allowed in the house?" "They are tonight," said her mother. "Everything's different tonight, isn't it?" said Maddie. "It is," said her father. With a sadness that was undeniable, he beckoned me into the small kitchen to get our drinks. "Maddie's ill," he said. "Very ill, so everything is different for us now. 2 weeks ago, we never imagined this would be her last Christmas, but the... can't even say the word. It's very aggressive, crazy. They don't expect more than a few weeks if we're lucky, so everything is different." I looked with a kind of shame at the huge glasses of whiskey that Paul had poured for us. Too large, too celebratory. But we carried them back by the fire where Felipe and Jack had begun in close harmony, away in a manger, with Bianca providing the perfect image of beatific beasthood. She'd knelt beside the chair where Allison and Maddie sat, and as I watched, Maddie slipped from her mother's lap to the floor to look directly into Bianca's face as she stroked her head. And Bianca looked back. As the grown-ups began to talk and make the inevitable small-town connections in between the songs, the bond between the child and the goat grew. The minutes flew past, and then the bells from each of the three churches began to ring out midnight and a welcome to Christmas Day. At 12:15, we rose a little unsteadily, it must be said, having put away quite a quantity of scotch between us. The little girl was curled beside the goat, Bianca's nose tucked firmly in Maddie's ear. Her mother untangled the sleeping child from the drowsy kid and lifted her to her shoulder, seeing us to the door. "Thank you," she said. "It was magic, special." "Special magic," murmured Maddie, not lifting her head, eyes closed. "See you soon." Her parents looked sadder than I could imagine two young, lovely people could look, standing on the porch with their little daughter wrapped in the blanket, waving us off into the snow. I thought about Maddie off and on all that year. I thought I saw her in the street. I thought I saw her parents. I should have seen them in such a tiny place, but I never was sure it was them, and I couldn't bear to ask someone who might have known. But Christmas Eve had come again, and Felipe and Jack and my new husband and I had gone caroling again, sans Bianca, who had gone to live with some other goat friends. A loss that Felipe was feeling very keenly. And now we'd arrived at the bungalow where we'd been so warmly welcomed the year before, and we stood debating. I don't think I can bear it," I said, nursing my own new sweet hope. "I don't think I can see their sad faces." "We may be exactly what they need," said Felipe. We'll know. If not, we'll go." So up the steps we went and began a spirited version of "God Rest Ye Merry Gentlemen." At once, the door was flung open by a child who seemed a version of Maddie, a pinker, rounder, bolder, brighter child, and behind her a woman no longer transparent with grief. "Come in, come in. We wondered if we'd see you again. We hoped you'd come. Where's Bianca?" And into the same warm room with the same glowing wood stove, but a new story woven around the three. Out came the scotch, and in the kitchen where I took hot chocolate instead, Paul would only say in answer to my question, "Ask Maddie." So we did, and Maddie told us that when the bells rang out the Christmas Eve past, what Felipe had thought was Bianca's insatiable appetite for salty ears was, in fact, a secret. "A secret," I said to Maddie. "What sort of secret?" "A lovely one. A one-word one. A once-only-ever one." "Ah, what word?" And with a look of joy at her mother, who knew the story and knew the ending, and who looked back at her daughter with a sweetness that I recognize now, Maddie said, "Live." She said, live. Well, we all have naughty and nice on our Christmas lists every year, and this offering is for the naughties. As a joke, my brother used to hang a pair of pantyhose over his fireplace before Christmas. He said all he wanted was for Santa to fill them. Now, what they say about Santa checking the list twice must be true, because every Christmas morning, although Jay's children's stockings overflowed, his poor pantyhose hung sadly empty. One year, though, I decided to make his dream come true. I put on a pair of sunglasses and a toque by way of a disguise, and I went in search of an inflatable life-sized doll. They don't sell those at Winners. I had to go to an adult store downtown. Now, I wanted a standard, uncomplicated doll that could also substitute as a passenger in my car so that I could use the carpool lane during the rush hours. Now, uncomplicated was difficult. These dolls come in many, many different models. I settled, finally, for lovable Louise, a girl on the very bottom rung of the price ladder. On Christmas Eve, with the help of an old bicycle pump, Louise came to life. My sister-in-law was in on the plan, and she snuck me in late Christmas Eve, long after Santa had been and gone. I filled the dangling pantyhose with Louise's pliant legs, and ate some cookies and drank what remained of a glass of milk on the tray. I went home, giggling into Christmas morning. Much later that morning, my brother called to say that Santa had been and left a present that made him very happy, but had confused the dog. She would bark, walk away, come back, bark some more, walk away, and so on. We all agreed that Louise should remain in her pantyhose so that the rest of the family could admire her when they came over for the traditional Christmas dinner. My grandmother noticed Louise the moment she walked through the door. "What the heck is that?" she asked, "and where are her clothes?" My brother quickly explained, "It's a doll. Who would play with something like that?" Granny snapped. I thought I could answer that, but a look at my brother convinced me to keep my mouth shut. "Boy, that turkey sure smells nice, Gran," he said, trying to steer her into the dining room. My grandfather, a delightful old man with poor eyesight, sidled up to me and said, "Hey, who's the naked gal by the fireplace?" I told him that she was Jay's new friend. A few minutes later, I noticed Grandpa by the mantel talking to Louise. Not just talking, flirting. The dinner went very well. Then, all of a sudden, Louise made a noise much better not heard at a polite dinner party and exploded from the pantyhose, flew around the room twice, and fell in a heap in front of the sofa. The cat screamed, and Grandpa ran across the room, fell to his knees, and began mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. My brother threw his wine over his trousers. My sister-in-law began to choke, and Granny threw down her napkin, stomped out of the room, and sat in the car for the rest of the evening. It was a Christmas to remember and to treasure. Later, in my brother's garage, we conducted a thorough examination to diagnose the cause of Louise's collapse. We discovered she'd suffered a hot ember to the back of her right thigh, but thanks to a wonder drug called duct tape, she was soon restored to perfect health. Louise went on to become something of a local celebrity, starring in several bachelor party movies. The special bond that was formed with Grandpa as he struggled to save her is not one that is easily broken. He still calls her whenever he can get out of the house, and he speaks often of his Christmas angel.
Thank you.
coming we had of it. Just the worst time of the year for a journey, and such a journey. The ways deep and the weather sharp, the very dead of winter, and the camels galled, sore-footed, refractory, lying down in the melting snow. There were times when we regretted the summer palaces on slopes, the terraces, and the silken girls bringing sherbet. Then the camel men cursing and grumbling and running away and wanting their liquor and women, and the night fires going out and the lack of shelters, and the cities hostile and the towns unfriendly, and the villages dirty and charging high prices. A hard time we had of it. At the end, we preferred to travel all night, sleeping in snatches, with the voices singing in our ears, saying that this was all folly. Then, at dawn, we came down to a temperate valley, wet below the snow line, smelling of vegetation, with a running stream and a water mill beating the darkness, and three trees on the low sky, and an old white horse galloped away in the meadow. Then we came to a tavern with vine leaves over the lintel, six hands at an open door, dicing for pieces of silver, and feet kicking the empty wineskins. But there was no information. And so we continued and arrived at evening, not a moment too soon finding the place. It was, you may say, satisfactory.
Thank you.
I would do it again. But set down this. Were we led all that way for birth or death? There was a birth, certainly. We had evidence and no doubt. I had seen birth and death, but had thought they were different. This birth was hard and bitter agony for us, like death, our death. We returned to our places, these kingdoms, but no longer at ease here in the old dispensation with an alien people clutching their gods. I should be glad of another death.
Maria, 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 Ma
dark steals all the blood from the scarred west. The stars come out and freeze my heart with drops of untouchable music, frail as ice and bitter as the New Year's cross. Where in the world has any voice prayed to you, lady, for the peace that's in your power? Where in the world has any city trusted you? Out where the soldiers camp, the guns begin to thump, and another winter time comes down to seal our years in ice. The fields are mute. There are no voices in the wood. And trees make gallows up against the sharp-eyed stars. Oh, where will Christ be killed again? In the land of these dead men. Lady, the night has got us by the heart. And the whole world is tumbling down. Words turn to ice in my dry throat, praying for a land without prayer. Walking to you on water all winter, in a year that wants more war. Where in the world has any voice prayed to you, lady? For the peace that's in your power. Where in the world has any voice prayed to you, lady, for the peace that's in your power? What sweeter music can we bring than a carol for to sing the birth of this our heavenly King? Awake the voice, awake the string, heart, ear, and eye, and everything. Dark and dull night, fly hence away and give the honor to this day that sees December turned to May. We see him come. We know him ours, who with his sunshine and his showers turns all the patient ground to flowers. The darling of the world is come, and fit it is we find a room to welcome him. The nobler part of all the house here is the heart, which we will give him, and bequeath this holly and this ivy wreath, to do him honor, who's our King, the Lord of all this reveling.
Make me joy now in this fest, in for trees of Scotia's fest. Hail,
a patrimony generous, through my maiden's country house, singing of English steelmaker,
to see to their graces, their
friends, as years go on and heads get gray, how fast the guests do go. Touch hands with those that stay, strong hands to weak, old hands to young, around the Christmas board, touch hands. The false forget, the foe forgive, for every guest will go and every fire burn low and cabin empty stand. Forget, forgive, for who may say that Christmas Day may ever come to host or guest again? Touch hands.